Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we will make a start just a couple of minutes after due time, which is pretty good given the length of those lunch queues. So thank you very much for coming in promptly. There are still a few coming in, so maybe a little bit of hubbub as we get this session underway. Sustainability through sport. I know for most of you, you know how important that is, how critical it is, and what work is being done to enhance the opportunities that sport can bring in a sustainable way. And we have a panel which represents all the levels from sport through to international organizations working towards those goals. And I think you'll get a very interesting and clear spread of thoughts, of ideas, of practical ideas as well, as to how best perhaps to implement some projects which would make a difference within your sport and perhaps where sports can make a difference to our environment. So thank you for coming. You may well be aware that on Monday, on the 8th of October, the IOC's sustainability report, the first one, will be published. It will be presented by Prince Albert of Monaco, who's been leading the sustainability work with the IOC. A couple of things that came to mind there, because this is talking about progress on 18 different sustainability objectives by 2020, and in the words of His Serene Highness, momentum is building, change is occurring, and we need to build on it. And that's something that perhaps we can focus on in the course of this session. The IOC President, Thomas Bach, has said sustainability is now fully embedded throughout the entire life cycle of the Olympic Games, from candidature to planning to delivery to legacy. So from an IOC perspective, this is the new normal. And he's also talked about ways in which we have to evolve. So what is perhaps the next stage in that process? As we're going to cover a lot of ground here, I think the best way we have to start is to talk to some athletes, some people who are involved in sports which very directly impact on their environment, or indeed come from a part of the world which is very directly impacted by climate change, by the changes in the world at the moment. So my first job is to invite onto the stage Alex Diebold. Alex, who is the bronze medalist in the snowboarder. Thank you very much.
Snowboard cross.
And I, having been onto Alex's Instagram and Twitter sites as well, snowboarding is just one of the things he does, but he does anything that is fast and a bit dangerous, as far as I could see, all out in the environment, which of course is important. So Alex, over to you for a few minutes.
Thank you so much. Cold air rushing over your face. So gather speed, head down the mountain, only to lean back and float through the snow, effortlessly weightless. To me, this is one of the greatest feelings in the world. And to me, this is what snowboarding is all about. This is something that I've been passionate about my entire life. Let's see if we can get my clicker to work. Maybe not. There we go. This is Christmas break, 1992, about 6 years old in this photo. Now, at this point, I had no idea all the places that a little piece of plastic and fiberglass was going to take me. Competing on five different continents, standing on an Olympic podium, and eventually even introducing me to my wife. I got involved with an organization called Protect Our Winters, a nonprofit that focuses on turning outdoor enthusiasts into effective climate advocates. And I got involved because I wanted future generations to have all of the same opportunities that I had. One of the main reasons I got involved was because I was seeing changes firsthand. This is Christmas 2015, and I'm standing about 10 meters from where that last photo was taken. For me, this is what's unacceptable. Now, sustainability is now one of the pillars, three pillars of the IOC agenda in 2020. But it's going to have a global outreach. And I'm seeing all these changes at home. It's not just at home. It's all over the place where I travel. This is a competition in Austria of last season, the Alps. This is World Championships, one of our premier events in Sierra Nevada, Spain, at the highest resort in the country. This is happening all over. Now, what are we gonna, as a snowboarder, what are we gonna do about it? We're gonna use our voice. We are going to try and lead by example. Could certainly come up here and list off a bunch of scary facts about the largest sources of global warming, about the hottest years on record. Could show you a climate map of temperature anomalies all over the world. These things don't matter. To protect our winters, we've worked with everyone from climatologists to Harvard professors, the former director of the EPA, to gather this information, to educate the masses and turn people into effective climate advocates. For a long time, I've been going around to schools, talking to kids about how important it is to recycle, carpool, turn lights off. And while these things are all vastly important, those small steps aren't going to be enough to make a difference. At Protect Our Winters, we've had to change our focus from talking about reusable water bottles to talking about systemic policy change. It's not enough. It has to start at the top. And for the policymakers in the US, they know all this stuff. They've seen all this information. They know the numbers. And it's not enough to get them to move. It's not enough to make a real change. And so we've had to figure out what numbers they do care about. 887 billion dollars. That's a number that they care about. That's the amount of money that outdoor enthusiasts spend annually in the US. Every year, that's a lot of tax revenue. You look at some of the other things that people are spending that much money on, it puts us in some pretty elite company. So at Protect Our Winters, we're using this number to get the attention of the policymakers. We're using this information to meet with our elected representatives and tell them that we care about climate and we care about a sustainable future, a clean, sustainable energy future. Those are the numbers that they care about. Now, maybe you don't have access to your leadership the way we do. I live in Salt Lake City, Utah. I have my senator on speed dial. I call him all the time to let him know that I care. But maybe that's not an option for you. What does your roadmap look like? What are things that you can do to get involved? Internationally, you can work with organizations like Greenpeace or Conservation International if you don't have this sort of access to your government. You can tell them that these issues matter to you. And as an athlete, I want to go to the IOC and tell them these issues matter to us. So I touched briefly on Agenda 2020. I think the IOC is taking a step in the right direction. But honestly, I really don't think it's enough. It's important to green your own house, to turn off your lights and recycle, but that's not going to be enough to make a difference. The IOC is in such a unique position. And I can tell you what's at stake if we don't make systemic policy change from the top. It's moments of pure joy because the air is so polluted that athletes can't compete outside. It's moments of immense triumph gone because there's not enough snow to compete on anymore. And most importantly to me, it's moments of unity like I have never witnessed anywhere else in the world. This is what's at stake. This is what's at stake if the IOC doesn't lead by example and demand that when we go to a new host nation, a city has to have clean, sustainable energy sources. Not necessarily just for their venues, but across all demographics. They can demand that transportation is carbon neutral to get to and from venues. These are things that are going to have a lasting, sustainable impact for a long time. It's not just during the game, but this can be part of their legacy. And most importantly, to me, I think that they can go to their partners and their sponsors from the top and say, if you want to be part of this, if you want to be part of this Olympic movement that everyone here, that's why we're all here, because we care about, you want to be involved in that, then you have to align with our values if you want to be a part of this. You have to align with our vision for the future. And so again, it's starting with the IOC, it's starting with policy from the top down. And as an athlete, that's what I want to demand of them. As constituents, that's what you can demand of them. So I know a lot of the time talking about climate change is usually a pretty scary or glum or depressing subject. At Protect Our Winners, we've shifted a lot of our brand messaging, and now what we're talking about is turning your passion into purpose. Turn your passion as an outdoor enthusiast into purpose for making change. And so what I think we need to do here is take our passion for the Olympic movement and turn it into purpose for effective climate policy change. Thank you.
Alex, thank you very much indeed. Come take a seat. Thank you. Just before I introduce David, I just wonder, you picked up, you made a very clear challenge in these very challenging seats that we're all going to discover. They have a life of their own, I'm afraid.
Hopefully my balance is up to the task.
Yeah, you should be all right. Towards the IOC, a challenge to the IOC there. What about, if I can just ask now, your view of maybe your IF, your International Federation? I mean, I see there are several presidents and senior figures from what I might call outdoor IFs here. Obviously, they have an important role to play. Do you think they're doing enough?
Honestly, I mean, I don't think anybody's doing enough just yet. I mean, there's very small groups. But for my own personal group, I'm a member of the U.S. Ski and Snowboard team, and that's our NGB. And I went to them and said, how are we... like, what are we doing? Because skiing and snowboarding depends on cold, sustainable winters where we have consistent snowfall. And so they formed a sustainability committee. I'm privileged and fortunate to be a part of that. You know, we started the same way the IOC did, is greening our own house. We started installing solar panels on the roof of our building at home. They just started a rideshare program for commuters to be able to get to work at the same time. Where our headquarters is based, vehicle admissions is the number one cause of some pretty serious weather issues that we have at home. And so it's a step in the right direction, but I don't think that they're doing enough yet.
Okay, thank you for that. I mean, we're going to talk about partnerships and the opportunities for building those in the course of this session. First, though, we're going to turn from, I mean, you just talked about a sport, which your sport's being ruined to a certain extent by the conditions that you have to work in. Our next guest is seeing his home, his livelihood, his life destroyed by climate change. And that's because David Katoato is from Kiribati, which, as you will know, is one of the first nations likely to go under as the seas rise and climate change worsens. David is also a Commonwealth gold medalist weightlifter and multiple Olympian. So, David, please come and join us. Come up here. I'll hold the stool. Got it. Excellent. Thanks for joining us. I think the first thing I want to do really is just to put a bit of context here. Many of you will know far more than I do about Kiribati, but I do know, having been down in the region, you have a population across the islands of, what, 100,000, roughly, 100,000 people. There are not many Commonwealth gold medalists and Olympians among them, maybe one, and this is you. So I'm going to ask you about the importance of that role as an influencer, but first of all, just tell us a little bit about your home.
Thank you, David. In Kiribati, the climate change is real. And I know that when I'm staying now in Kiribati, I can see my home covered by my land covered the sea. And that's will affect our water, because we always drink water from under the ground. And this is now we always go find somewhere to get something to drink, because when the sea covers the land, we can't do, like, because we sour from the under the water, like we, you know, the well. And that's the effect like climate change. And also it's not only in Kiribati, but all the Pacific Island will affect by climate change. And every time I visit the school to awareness, because I tell them that I always fight for the future, for the new generation. And this is always to, because the climate change is inside my heart. Like I believe that I always speak to the leaders of the world to stop and like to, because they always use the greenhouse gas, have to cut down and.
How old are you?
I am 34.
34, okay. So can you remember a different Kiribati when you were a little boy? I mean, was it a different place there? Has it changed that much in your lifetime?
Well, when I was young in Kiribati, the sea was, when I stepped before, was 8 feet, and now it's only 2 steps. Like, I know that the climate change is real, but I know it's gonna be affect all the small islands in the Pacific. And that's why I always raise my voice to tell the leaders of the world to protect our Pacific island.
Now, we've heard from one role model already. You are clearly another for your community. What sort of things are you doing? What messages are you are you going into schools? Are you telling youngsters what they've got to do? And can you, what are you doing?
Well, I always send my message to the world, save my country. And that's very important, because we are affected right now. That's the problem.
So in a way, maybe you don't need to tell your own people in Kiribati. They know very well what the situation is.
Yeah, the message that I always tell the world, that's the save my country. Because I tell them that to be strong, fight for this problem. And that's what we always do.
Can I ask you, Alex, then, again, you mentioned you have access to your senator and you bug him daily, which is good. First of all, does it get anywhere? Is it making a difference, that sort of penetration, that sort of access?
So the reason that I have to bug my senator, both of my senators in the state of Utah so often, is because they're both avid climate deniers. When I first got involved with Protect Our Winters, we were going to a lot of layup meetings where we'd go into a room where people believed in climate change, they were concerned about policy change, and we realized that sort of taking the easy road wasn't going to help us change things. We had to sort of, you know, pull up our sleeves and get into the fight. And so I contact my senators almost daily because they, you know, they're deniers, and I want them to know that their constituents care. And so,
sorry to interrupt you, though. And you've got access because you're an Olympian, because you're a bronze medalist, because you're clearly a great sportsman, or because you're a member of the public and you can.
Because I'm a member of the public and I can. I will say that my Olympic medal has certainly opened doors, and I've spent several trips going to Washington D.C. to lobby Congress. And when you pull an Olympic medal out of your pocket and put it on the table, it certainly gets their attention. Because, you know, they're used to meeting with all sorts of leaders and dignitaries, and that's how I use that to sort of get my message across. But more than just calling my senators every day, one of the things that I'm doing personally to try and, first of all, is to vote them out. People, if you don't believe in climate change and you're not working to change it, you're either dumb or evil. Which one is it? And what we're doing is working really hard to get the vote out. You know, voting in midterm elections and in the United States has been pretty deplorably low. It's almost embarrassing. And so I've been going more than calling my senators. I go door to door in select neighborhoods with certain candidates to remind people that there's an upcoming election. And so that's, you know, more than calling my senators, I feel like that's how I'm trying to make a difference, is to get people out and vote.
Right, important lobbying role to play. I was struck also, because I think it will be picked up a little bit later by your commentary, that is the most important thing to do, which is to chase policy, really, rather than small steps. But small steps build up, don't they? We, in sport, everyone talks about marginal gains. I mean, that's the way ahead. You don't want to discourage that, presumably.
No, of course not. And that's why I made sure to preference it by saying, like, those steps are all incredibly important. Recycling and commuting and carpooling, you know, turning lights off. The things as small as, like, changing the light bulbs in your house to run on low effective, you know, LEDs and using reusable bags. That was always a big thing for me. When you go to the grocery store, use reusable bags. Well, one way that really got that to change was a lot of cities and states outlawed them. So you have to, you know, in the States, we're finally catching up with a lot of the rest of the world. You have to pay for a bag if you want it now. So it really gets people to think about it differently. And for me, for a long time, until very recently, honestly, I was very focused on all of those small steps. Recycle, you know, reuse, reduce, recycle. Those were things that were sort of my message and that I was telling kids about. But as I've learned more and experienced, you know, a lot of situations, I have now come to learn that policy change is sort of more of the forefront of my fight, I should say.
Okay, that's very interesting. David, this point is, we're talking about sustainability through sport. You are a very powerful figure because of sport within your communities, and I'm still just trying to work out how you leverage that. How do you make the most of that? Because I imagine when the time comes for David Katoatu to say something, people are listening in your neighborhood.
Yeah, well, I'm sorry, because my English is not that good, because it's my second language.
It's pretty good, yeah, you're doing very well.
Yeah, I wanted to say that in Kiribati, always visit the school and sharing about my experience. And I always do the dancing, because to pay attention to the world. And it makes me like feel proud, because, and the people know the world, they know where the Kiribati, because in the Pacific Island. That's why I always want to tell the world, like, in the Pacific we are infected, but we beg you to please stop the, cut down the greenhouse gas, because we are now affected, and then only thing to do to, because God create our, and we thank God for everything that's always.
The message is it's out of your hands, yeah, but it's very much in your heart to try to persuade and to inspire people to make a difference.
That's true.
David made a reference to dancing there, which for a weightlifter is an interesting marry up of opportunity. But those of you who know David's achievements will know also that when he won the Commonwealth gold medal, he had just had his last lift, and it was a bold effort, didn't quite come off, but he'd won gold, a Kiribati gold, first one ever. And when the music started, so did he. Yeah, congratulations to that. I've got to say, we were talking about it earlier, the dance, you've got to see it to believe it. So I'm going to get them to put the music up for us.
Mystic DJ.
Give me that. You've just won gold. Give us a bit. Ladies and gentlemen, that is the way to celebrate a gold medal. David, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
You're a very good sport. Before we close this session, Alex.
Yeah, I wanted to. That's a perfect example. I think that like dancing like that takes a lot of courage. It takes a lot of courage to put yourself out there, and as athletes, or brand, or an International Olympic Committee, it takes a lot of courage to stick your neck out and talk about climate change and that you're willing to risk some of the blowback from it. So I think that is a great analogy of what it takes to be able to take on this monumental challenge.
I certainly wouldn't do it, but I did have the courage to ask someone who's a bit stronger than me to go and do it. Thank you both very much indeed, much appreciated. Stay with us, please, up on the platform. I want to move us on into another realm now, which is about, as in fact Alex referred to, it's about the power of partnership, and that's, I think, where much of our discussion is going to go now. Sport is not the driver of necessarily the great enabler and awareness factor of our environmental challenges. That comes from many different directions. And one of them, clearly, is from business, as in from partners within sport. And that is where our next speaker comes in, because I'd like to ask Nicoletta to join us. Nicoletta Piccolo-Ravazzi. Come up on stage, Nicoletta. She is... working with Dow, very much an important partner with the Olympic Committee and the Olympic movement. And I think we could get a snapshot of what you do through we've got a little video, haven't we, to play. Let's have the video first. Sweet and to the point. Thank you. We appreciate that. Your full title is, you're Director of Dow Global Technology and Sustainability. But I think it's interesting, the story of the genesis of your role, of Dow's role within sustainability in the Olympics. But perhaps you can just enlighten us, because it wasn't necessarily your thing, was it?
Yeah. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm delighted to be here today and to talk about partnership. We came to the realization that we can't do it on our own, and this is why we are here. And the video that you just saw is about the concept of leading the blueprint, which is really taking us from just focusing on our own operations, what we call our footprint, to talking about our handprint, which are our products, to the next level, which is partnerships. And as you said, David, when we started as a top partner in 2010, Dow is the official chemistry company of the Olympic movement. And as we progressed in this partnership and evolved, we realized that we could actually do much more than provide our technology and chemistry solutions to the games and to the build-out of the games. We realized that we could bring our sustainability expertise and our science-based thinking to the games and do things that took us way beyond being the official chemistry partner, to be today, since 2017, the official carbon partner of the IOC. And we started this with the Sochi Olympic Games. We were the official carbon partner of the Sochi Games, and we developed a program with the Sochi Games that would not only offset the footprint of the games, but would also develop projects in energy efficiency, for instance, of buildings throughout Russia.
But their message was to you, wasn't it? Come and help us.
Yes.
We don't need chemicals. We do need sustainability.
Exactly. Yeah, so that was the conversation that I shared with you, with the head of sustainability of the Sochi Games, who said, you have great products, but I don't buy any of these products. You know, we make materials that are not in the purchasing list of an organizing committee. But I have a commitment to offset the footprint of the games. And so how can you help us? And the way we wanted to help was by using our and our customers' chemistry-based solutions. So we implemented a number of projects, which is what we do best. work with business to deliver projects. And not only did we just want to do something, we wanted also to lead to measurable results. So today, our projects that we have implemented in Russia have delivered more than 2.7 million tons of CO2 reductions.
Huge. Let me ask you then what your attitude was, maybe what Sochi's was at the time. We have to do this. It's a sort of shrug. Oh my goodness, how are we going to? We better find someone who can help us doing it. Now, that, in a way, that's a very negative positive. Has it changed?
Yeah, we go back to the power of sport. You know, the power of sport is to catalyze the type of conversation, to make it more inspiring, to change the type of conversation. Like Alex said, we use the marketing power of the brand to bring people to the table and to have a completely different conversation with our customers than what we would normally have. So we went to see these Russian firms and said, we want to reduce CO2 emissions for the Sochi Games. And they were really surprised about that, because that was not in the mainstream thinking of these organizations and also of the general public in Russia. And in fact, we had a very hard time to tell the story about our partnership with Sochi in Russia, because it was not an understood problem. I think we have evolved from there. We, in Rio, this story of a partnership around carbon was much more mainstream and easy and early understood. And today that we are the official carbon partner of the IOC, we can take it beyond the games and really have a global platform where we can implement projects that lead to CO2 reduction results.
I guess even for you, the challenge in some ways is not necessarily to meet the target, but to extend the awareness of what's being done and keeping that going. I mean, it is just a fact, isn't it, that an Olympic Games comes to a city or any of thousands of different sports events, they come and then they go. And I suppose, in a sense, you've got people everywhere. You've got to stay, you've got to see it, and you've got to see it through.
Yes, that's exactly true. I mean, we are there before an Olympic Games is awarded. In most countries, we have a presence. We were 40 years in Russia before the Games happened. We were 60 years in Brazil, and we are there to stay. So we are actually nurturing the projects and continuing to verify the results as athletes and media and everybody else leaves the Games. And that's where it's really important for us to be able to do this as a partner of the IOC, so that we go away from this start and go of the Games, that we create a continuous effort that we then can continuously nurture and bring to fruition.
Now, you're sitting up here, and we're delighted to have you here, but Dow makes, among other things, manufactures plastics, and they sell very well, but they, as we've all seen, they don't do our environment a lot of good. How do you deal with that? Are you on a mission to change your direction, or do you accept that sticks a little bit?
Well, you know, we create these plastics. We do not want to see them in the environment. Plastics do not belong in the environment, but we believe that plastics belong in a circular economy. And there are many things that need to happen to get us there, many steps of that value chain, including the end of life, the use of materials so that they are more recycle ready. Many different things can lead us to a responsible use of plastics in a circular economy. And I have one example to give you, which started actually in 2012, when probably the conversation was a bit different, around the London Games. Dow provided the stadium wrap for the London Games, and that was a temporary kind of material, and
clarify, do you understand that, the wrap around the stadium? I don't know if you remember it. It was a wonderful thing to look at, with a great big plastic wrap right around the stadium.
Yeah, it created the centerpiece, the decoration around the stadium, and we actually recycled that wrap after its use. It was a temporary use that had been specified, and it was also repurposed in two different projects in Uganda and in Brazil. And I make that point because it helped us to understand the value of doing a sustainability program in the Olympic Games. It was our first Olympic Games as a partner, and it has really helped us to shape some thinking.
Do you think that you, a business like yours, is seen as a bit of a, I'd use the term, a whipping boy? You get a bad press, do you think?
I do think that we are a big organization that has a lot of good science thinking and good products. And if we put them to use in partnerships throughout the value chain, we can make a big impact. And so I think that's the power, really, of a corporation such as DAO, that we can make things happen. And so I think when we do that, when we make things happen, when we help solve problems that people see and feel, like we were talking here about climate change, then we are seen in a positive way.
So this is a perspective, I suppose, of partnership. Alex was talking about the challenges, the impossible challenges of doing things on your own. You've got to look for partners who will see things the way you will see them. Any exciting projects coming up?
We are actually developing now a portfolio of carbon projects for our partnership with the IOC. They will be in different application areas, from high-rise buildings, super tall buildings, and how we make them more energy efficient, for instance, to projects in also industrial as well as in packaging applications.
Right. Partly the reason I ask is because, as we heard this morning, Thomas Bach saying, we have to evolve, we have to evolve, and I think everyone would agree with that. And I'm wondering where the driving force is coming from. Is it from you looking at the landscape and saying, oh, you should think about doing this and that, IOC? Or is it the IOC coming to you and saying, you need to help us to solve this or that?
Well, we actually very much work in partnership. We review the project proposals on a regular basis. I think where we need the IOC is to help us engage the value chain. For us, it's very easy to talk to our customers, but it's very difficult to talk to our customers, to the brand owners, and to the consumers. And that's really where the power of the IOC brand helps us, so that we can create a multiplier, that we can do more. If we have identified one opportunity in a building, how can we get 100 buildings to adopt the same technology? And that's really where coming together between science and sports can help us catalyze change.
Okay, well, thank you very much indeed for that, for enlightening us on the way in which things have actually evolved over a very short period of time, in fact, since Sochi. I just want to bring your attention to our word cloud, because we're going to come to this at the end. If you were in a session this morning, you will have taken part in a word cloud. I hope you all know what I'm talking about. Yes? Generally?
It's possibly, on the app.
Hopefully. It's on the app, so you need to have, A, downloaded the app, the Olympism in Action app, which I hope you've done. And then in a little while, I will ask you to access the app and we will go to Word Cloud. You will press the Word Cloud, go down to our session, the Sustainability in Sport session, and you can put in the word which comes to your mind most readily from the sustainability discussions that we've been having so far. Maybe you've got two or three words. Well, then just put one in, then the next. Submit them each at a time, and we'll come up with our word cloud at the end of it. But I just want to alert you now, so get ready. It's very easy. I did it. It's very easy. We can do it. But we're going to move on to the next stage of our discussion now, and we are really broadening out on partnership, on ways in which sport and international organizations and the UN can work together. So can I ask all three of my next three speakers to come up onto the stage? So this is branching a long way beyond just sport to those people who have environmental issues at the very heart of what they do. Julia Carboni is the Deputy Director of the Business and Biodiversity Program at the IUCN, or the International Union for Conservation of Nature, and she was very impressed when I added "and natural resources," because that is the full title. Jean-Christophe Roland is president of the International Rowing Federation, and Leo Hilleman is has served as the UN Environment Programme's Regional Director for Latin America and the Caribbean since February 2016. So thank you all three for joining us. And we're just going to start with a quick hit on each of you, because I know you've all got a video to play us as well, and we'd like to get to see that. But Julia, your ultimate role in life is what in the UICN, the aim?
The aim of UICN is... Oh, thank you. Our aim is really to conserve nature and natural resources in a way that is just, but is also in the long term enables, you know, future generations still to have a planet to live on. So when my children ask, you know, the friends of my children say, "What does your mommy do?" And I say, "I save the planet."
Someone's got to do it.
So that's in a short, but effectively, I mean, today we quickly talked about, you know, sustainable development and all the different aspects, and there is a competition. Well, that's, you know, we focus on nature, but effectively, I think the point is that they're all connected. So yes, I do work on biodiversity conservation, but I also feel like I'm contributing to a lot of other aspects of sustainability, because nature is at the base of poverty and zero hunger. We were talking about, you know, a number of sustainable goals that...
Really important point, which I think we'll come back to as well. But let's just get a flavor through the video of the work you do. I think it's probably fair to say, Julie, you don't care who it is who's helping. Everyone's got to do their bit, and sport is within a panoply of organisations that do have to help. But what is your experience of the way in which sport and perhaps sports organisations do or don't embrace what you're campaigning for?
Well, my personal experience actually has been very positive. We started working with the International Olympic Committee 2 years ago. We have a formal engagement, and so far I've been extremely positively impressed by the constructive and the energy that really all the federations have been to a number of meetings, that really people in this sector are really they really care, and they want to try to find ways to play their role. And this is where I agree with the fact that, you know, you need policy, and absolutely I'm an advocate for good policy, but I also know that every single action, bigger and also the smaller one, each of them really counts. So when working with IOC, they have an incredible level of influence, maybe not so much direct control, but the influence is incredibly important. And how do we, you know, multiply that, and how do we get sports federation to work and take action and influence the fans? This is basically the theory of change that has put us in the same room with IOC and working together.
Yeah, short of laws, influence is everything, isn't it? And Jean-Christophe, you're in the hot seat in a way, because we're expecting IFs to do stuff, to make a difference. Introduce us to a little bit of the work that you've been doing within the International Rowing Federation.
Yeah, good afternoon. And actually, you know, sport can really contribute. We cannot ignore all what is happening in the world and in terms of global climate change and all the impact of that humans have on Earth. So the sport will not save the world, but can contribute. And as an international federation, obviously, we cannot ignore, and we cannot. We have to make that contribution. So, just to give you an example, we have that commitment at the very beginning of our statutes. It means in the Declaration of Principle, we commit to contribute to the protection of environment and to sustainability, as and sustainability is not limited to environment. And then we have developed actually a policy and a sustainability and environmental guidelines to help our federations, to help the organizers of big event on how they can contribute. And it starts with quite simple simple examples, but it's important that we can help all these organizations to contribute, to tackle and to address all this impact on the environment.
We get some practical sort of expression of that through, you have a video as well, I think, which we can show. Could we bring up the video for Jean-Christophe? Okay, so that's, I mean, you just get the feel of the outdoors world and why it should matter to you as a sport. This is the FISA's Environmental Sustainability Policy and Guidelines. It's quite a hefty tome. You put a lot of work into there, that is clear. I just wonder, how much of a cost is this to you as an international federation? I'm not asking for numbers, but, you know, this is a huge amount of work, and it's come on top of something that 5 to 10 years ago wasn't really there at all. And you're not the poorest IF in the world, so I'm just trying to gauge how difficult some of this is.
Well, it's not about cost, but you know, as you have seen, rowing is an outdoor sport, and we are intimately linked with nature, and that's why all the rowers are mindful that protecting the environment is essential. So it's certainly a lot of work just to find the way that we can all contribute and to help all these organizations to contribute. It starts, and I will echo what it was said just before, it can be seen as very little details, but when we put all these details all together, it makes things happen. And if you want to improve, you have to measure. If you want to improve, you have it's better to have a kind of guidelines. So that's why we have put in this our effort, and that's why also we have been helped to do so by WWF. No need to present this organization. We have signed a partnership with WWF because we have a common, I would say, goal to protect fresh water. And I'm sure you know that only 1% of the water in the world is clean or fresh, and more than 1 billion of people on the earth don't have access to clean water. So it's a common, I would say, a goal we have with WWF, and that's why we have been developing this partnership, that they help us a lot to produce this document.
Okay, I didn't know that only 1% of the world's water is clean water. That's frightening. Leo, let me ask about UN environment, and obviously it works closely with the IOC in some areas, but tell us a little bit about how that interaction works.
Well, first of all, I'd like to express appreciation to the International Olympic Committee for inviting UN Environment to participate in this important forum. We have actually been working a long time, since 1994, we started our relationship with the IOC. And as a result of that, we have been involved in pushing, motivating, evolving sustainability concept within the organization. We have participated in a number of the Olympics in terms of influence, for example, the Rio Olympics, the Turin Olympics, the Athens Olympics. And so we find now with these types of partnerships, we are able to reach further, reach a much larger public, and involve many more people in the concept of sustainability. I will give you a recent example for in terms of agreements or partnerships with the IAAF and jointly with the Climate and Clean Air Coalition. We've just did an agreement focusing on air pollution. Why? Because athletes are passionate about clean air. It's a problem for them. And when we look at the situation globally, about 7 million people die every year prematurely because of air pollution. So it's something that affects us directly. And this agreement is looking at trying to have in all of the athletic stadiums around the world some form of measurement that can let athletes know about the pollution that's available in the air that's affecting them directly. But that's not the important thing. The important thing is that that information is power, and that information can change policies and can change behavioral patterns and can involve many others in terms of pushing the boundaries in moving towards a cleaner atmosphere in that case.
Given your track record, I'm going to ask you a question about the impact sport can have in a moment, but we have a video from UN Environment as well, so if we could just play that and get the pictures, please. So some great examples of great work, but an indication as to how much we've still got to get on with and deal with. Can I just say, ladies and gentlemen, you may have noticed or not, but His Serene Highness Prince Albert of Monaco has joined us as well. You're going to be presenting your report on sustainability on Monday, I believe, Your Highness. I quoted you earlier, momentum is building, change is occurring. And Leo, perhaps I could use that actually as a nice little bridge to what has been the impact, in your view, of sport getting more involved in some of these big projects?
I will give an example of the Clean Seas program. The campaign has gathered a tremendous amount of interest and participation by at least 10 national Olympic committees, the IOC, the sailing, international sailing authorities, the Volvo race that was held last year and this year that really attracted a lot of attention in over 50 countries. And that combined with the program for the World Environment Day, where we pushed the idea of a world free of plastic pollution, what impact did that have? I'll give you some concrete examples. In this region, Chile, the day before the World Environment Day, announced one of the strongest packages of legislation on plastic pollution. Uruguay is doing something similar on plastic bags. Peru is also negotiating legislation on that. Panama just did this year legislation on that. Belize just announced legislation on that. Ecuador has banned the plastics going into the Galapagos Island and is moving towards. So the key thing here really was that awareness raising that came out of various programs combined with sport that really had that major impact in terms of motivating change and motivating participation of very diverse groups at addressing problems that affect society as a whole. So I think that encompasses a bit of, it's not sports alone. Sports can reach many, but it's everything, it's everybody. And if we are talking of partnerships, once you can, if I can give a message now, my message would be, it would be fantastic if all the sporting associations, all the national committees identify an issue that they are passionate about, that they are motivated about, that affects their environment. It can be their local community, it can be their city, it can be their forest, it can be the nation, or it can be a global issue like the air pollution with the IAAF. And if you can have that power of influence at the local level, generated through sport and through other activities that brings the awareness out to the public, you can make a huge change. And I think that would be a recommendation that I would make in terms of moving forward. We do work with a number of national committees, we do work with some global sporting bodies, but there's a lot more that can be done.
Julia, if we're talking about rowing or sailing or many winter sports, the connection's obvious for the athletes as well as it is for the governing bodies that this is our environment, we must look after it. Do you find it a harder act to work with sports which perhaps are indoor sports, which have less of a sense of the environment playing a role in their activity?
Well, I would have imagined so, in the sense that would have been natural to think that in our discussion we would have had an easier entry point with the, you know, sports that occur in natural environments. But we had a number of conversations recently. For example, one was about a very important and topical discussion on setting policies on no impact, no go in protected areas. And we had a number of sports that actually occur inside, like in kind of, you know, stadium, but they do, every sport in one way or the other has some, you know, impact on the outside environment, either because they have, you know, some seasonal field of plays outside, or just the venue participants come, but it hasn't been really one or the other. I mean, we have had a lot of good feedback also from other sports. And the other point we really want to try to make is also, of course, biodiversity in nature is very strong in, you know, what we call natural area or natural habitats or critical habitats. But there is also very important to bring nature and biodiversity in urban environment. And this is really something like IUCN is working very strongly on. And we believe that the sport movement and the Olympic movement really can bring this, you know, this concept to the wider public.
You talked about creating protected areas as well, which is critically important. Do you think sports have got that as well?
So creating protected areas is not the responsibility of sport federation at all. What is we feel like is responsibility of sport federations as well as businesses in general is to respect protected area and the values for which these areas were have been designated.
Jean-Christophe?
Yeah, absolutely. I fully agree. And actually, I can add on this that as FISA, we are very proud to have to be the first global sport body to protect UNESCO World Heritage Sites. We have pledged to UNESCO World Heritage Sites, and for us, this commitment has developed out through the World Rowing Clean Water partnership with WWF in response, actually, to these concerns raised by UNESCO that sport event can have impact and negative impact on world heritage sites. So that's why we have pledged, and we want to raise awareness so that when we organize sport event, and I would like that all the sports organization can also pledge on this commitment, so that we can respect all this natural and sites. And I don't know if you have been already to the Lake Bled in Slovenia. It's a fantastic environment, and obviously it's a sport. We want to use this fantastic environment, but at the same time we also have to ensure that we don't have a negative impact, so that we are in a process to mitigate the risk and to ensure that when we leave the site, it's in its best condition.
Yeah. Did you want to come in then, Nicolette?
I wanted to make a comment, yes, David. It's incredible when I see the journey that we have been on. When I look back, I've been involved in this since 2011, and it was all about the event and sort of reducing somewhat the footprint of that event, while now we are really, collectively realizing the potential to use sport, to go well beyond sport, to address problems and challenges that have a broader relevance in society. And so I think this is really great to see. So it's more not anymore about the sport, but how sport can influence and how we as scientists can partner with sport to influence society more broadly.
Do you wonder at all, though, if at the moment, you know, everything's about plastics, isn't it? I mean, the story is the plastic story at the moment. These things come and go a bit, or is that here to stay now, do you think?
Well, there are many stories. Climate change is a big story. Plastics is a story. I think what it forces us to do is to look really, to take a science-based approach and to take a life cycle thinking approach. We are doing that in our carbon projects. We're doing that on plastics too. Our economy is changing, and so we need to bring in sound life cycle-based decision making, and I think that's here to stay.
Part of the reason I asked Jean-Christophe is I wonder with IFs in particular, international federations, whether the key to success is to find to champion a cause really, and to be recognised for that one thing rather than necessarily spreading across the piece and sticking with that, and for every event and every competition that is your.
Yeah, as I said before, the unique power of sport is to be to be able to engage people, to influence people, and especially the youth, so that they can take all this aspect as a behavior. And when we are speaking with rowers, obviously they are the best ambassadors to protect the clean water. So obviously this is a good way. We will not, as such, as a sport body and FISA, will not change the world, but we can contribute and we can influence the youth and be sure that we can progress. One thing is very important, as an example, we ask the organizing committee to have a sustainable management and to develop sustainable management, so that they can really, really make an effort and make an improvement on what they are doing in this organization. And from one organization to another, we are improving, and that's the way we can all together contribute and to go in the right direction.
Keep the momentum going, Julia.
Yeah, I just wanted to add, I think, of course, the potential of advocacy and campaigning that sport federations have, or individual sports, and especially gold medalists have, is fantastic. But there is also the other quite important element of leading by example, and especially when you have venues and people go to these venues and see how things are managed. And a lot of these fans find these venues, basically they become their second homes, you know, going to the football games, and they regularly go, the skiing slopes, and seeing that things are done in a way that is, in, you know, sustainable, there is all the different measures in place. That's examples is something that they bring home. So it's not just the campaigning, but it's really leading by example. And this is what, you know, for example, with IOC, really tackling the issue of conservation, we are trying to help all the federations addressing biodiversity conservation at different stages, like in new venues, how when you organize events, how to manage, for example, invasive species. I mean, little bit of, you know, all the different sub-problems, but how to manage them in a way that they can also, when they have events, they feel proud. And then they can talk to their fans coming and say, we are doing everything there is to do. And you can take some of these lessons and also bring them home. Even, you know, for example, the whole question about invasive species and how athletes need to do things. It is not just about sport events. It's when you do sport as a recreation. And there is a lot to learn, but, you know, the best practices have to be implemented first.
Yeah, but are you seeing those examples coming across your desk in ever greater number now that sports are doing that? Or is it still really isolated to perhaps the bigger sports who can maybe afford to look on that sort of level?
Well, my direct audience is IUCN, some of the federations, and I find a very open mind and a lot of interest. Now, of course, there is a lot of work to do. I mean, mainstreaming, it's the most challenging things. We work in a lot of other sectors, so we see the same problem. It's easy to speak with the leaders. You get that first row and everybody's excited. The next big challenge is to mainstream.
Alex, are you heartened at all by hearing the enthusiasm actually that's coming from that side of the room, from the real campaigners, the people putting in the work? Because, you know, I've got to say you're a bit hacked off at the lack of progress and the lack of momentum.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's these, like, I ended up talking about how a lot of the conversation around climate change is pretty grim. And these are the stories that we need to be promoting, because there is hope and there is progress going on out there. I feel hacked by sort of my own closed network, my, you know, NGB or maybe RI, you know, International Federation, not sort of stepping up. But these are the sort of things that I can bring to them and bring to them examples. Like, these are what these other guys are doing, and these are how they're leading by example. We need to get on board, or we're going to be left in the dust.
Leo, how do you buy some of these sports in? How have you persuaded them to come in and work with you when it's not necessarily that obvious?
Well, I think it's a two-way street. For example, we have been able to have changes in places because, and partnerships because, a director or a person has made that first effort. Our director went to India, and Prime Minister Modi made a decision on in terms of plastics in the country, there's going to be a significant reduction. He went to a cricket competition, and an agreement with the cricket board of India was made in terms of reducing pollutions at all their venues. So sometimes it's the presence, sometimes it's because of general interest from members of the association or members of the sport in pushing forward. Sometimes it's from information that's available internationally. But it just takes actually one person to make the first step, and you can easily then start moving. With the IOC, it was just that. A director went to the IUC and made a step. In a couple of weeks' time, I'm going to a development bank, and hopefully there will be a partnership there. So it just need one person to have interest.
It's interesting because this morning in a panel on social inclusion, a very different topic, of course, there was a sense that it was time to move from ad hoc to systematic. You know, you're talking about ad hoc examples of things just happening out of one person knowing another or being in the right place at the right time. Julia, how systematic is this campaign and drive becoming? Is it a fair question to ask?
Yeah, no, it is very fair. And so there is a concept that I really like, which is called collective action, which basically rests on individuals still doing their job and taking the responsibility, but guided by a bigger plan. And so trying to everybody going in the right direction. So you need this kind of infrastructure that says this is the direction to go, but you still have to count on the individual responsibilities, because without that, we are just going to have maybe some nice policies, but you need the action on the ground. So the question is, who is in the best place to design that kind of framework to get all, in this case here we are talking about sports, all the federations and all the players to actually move in the same direction?
Okay, thank you very much indeed for that. Did you want to add to that, Jean-Christophe? Oh, you all do now. Okay. Jean-Christophe, then Leo, then we'll do the work.
I just want to add that I have the privilege to sit in the Sustainability and Legacy Commission in the IOC, led by His Royal Highness Prince Albert, and I can tell you that what you have mentioned is absolutely essential, and we do share with all the international federations all these best practices so that we can learn from the other and we can give to the other this best example. So I think we are on the good track on this dimension.
Yeah, just to back up what Julia was saying, in a systematic way, we have guidance and directives provided to us from the meetings of the World Ministers of Environment together, or from individual governments, or from the regional ministers, setting the direction and what they would like to have happen and what changes they would like to see. For example, the whole Clean Seas campaign came out of that type of joint effort at a meeting, and the issue on the reduction of pollution came out of a general theme in a meeting of all the ministers of environment, and that eventually ended up in many countries having legislation and a lot of action by individuals and by corporations and by cities and by different associations. So absolutely right, you know, a strategic approach, but that individual approach also gives results.
Okay, Leo, thank you very much indeed. Thanks for all of that. We've got our word cloud moment coming up now. I'm just going to remind you of the question, first of all. What sustainability issue will you take up in your daily life? On the basis, perhaps, of what we've heard here, that's a mighty question to have to commit to if you haven't thought about it, but I hope you have. So, you know the way to go. Get your mobiles out. Go to the Olympism in Action app. Are you with me? Is it happening? Good. Thank you very much. Can't see from the light.
No, you all have your phones out there.
Yep, good. Go to the word cloud, the yellow box, and up will come our section, which is right in the middle, sustainability through sport. We're going to put a clock on this. It started already. So get those words in there. You may have several words in your head. Submit them one by one, and let's see what the overall impact is. Okay, we're coming up to the clock there. This will still move on a little bit. That's my experience. But reduce is pretty big. Change, plastics are all the big words. And then, as you can see, a whole variety of responsibility, large scale, you name it, it's all up there. But those are the water action, reduce, change. I guess that's what we would want to see, isn't it, in terms of the messages that we are trying to put out, whether it's through sport, whether it's using sport as a tool, whichever way it might be. I think those are the messages. We have got a couple of minutes. I don't know if anyone would like, I don't really want questions because we don't have much time, but if you've got a brief remark that you'd like to throw into the pot, we'd be very pleased to have it. So we have one over here. If I could just grab a microphone. Just let us know who you are, where you're from.
Hi, everybody. Neil Beecroft, founding director of the NGO Sport and Sustainability International and former UEFA Euro 2016 Sustainability Project Leader. My question, it goes along what Alex said in terms of systemic change. How do you think in the period of 2 years, and this is what UN General Secretary gave us, to change and to save our planet, how in those 2 years we go from great progress to disruption?
That's a big question. It's a fair question, but a challenging one. You've got 2 minutes starting now. Anyone want to go? Alex, you can start. Maybe we should call on your Royal Highness. No, I won't do that to you now. That would be unfair. But it's a fair point. It's a race against time.
Go ahead.
It's a race against time, right? So I do think it's collaboration is the key. Yeah, I don't think, so it doesn't take me 2 minutes to say that, but I don't think we can solve any of these problems alone. It needs to have collaboration and new types of collaborations.
Okay, thank you. Nice succinct answer. A question.
I'll just add one thing real quick. You're talking about disruption. I think a quick way is
If you reference Nike's ad about Colin Kaepernick, has been this huge political pushback in the United States, and it's really garnered a massive amount of tension, because if you like give up everything if you don't believe in, you know, believe in something. So if a company or a group or an organization were to really push something that they believe in, and it was controversial, like, we're going to make these massive changes at the IOC, that's going to cause some pretty quick disruption.
Okay, thank you. As I say, remarks, not questions because of time, but we'll get two more remarks in if we can, maybe three if we're lucky.
My name is Isabel Fair. I'm the president of the Liechtenstein Olympic Committee. We're in the middle of the Alps, and we have good alpine skiers. And I just wondered whether you, Alex, do something in Europe as well for POW, or whether it's only in the U.S.?
No, POW has a global outreach. There are different, you know, there's, you know, POW is founded in the United States, but there's sections in Canada and Finland, Switzerland. They're all sort of nationally based. And so one of the things that I do is use, you know, unfortunately, I'm a bit of a veteran in my sport now, so I have a little bit of influence over some of the younger athletes, is I encourage them to all get involved on their local level with the regional outlets that they can. So if you don't have an organization in Switzerland, reach out to Protect Our Winners and help them start that in your area.
Okay, thank you. So we're going to get two more remarks. That might be it, though. First one here, sir.
Yes.
And then the lady there.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Luis Aviati. This is only just a short remark regarding what the lady answered to that gentleman. The answer is quite easy. We have to raise awareness, has to be risen, especially in these times in which we live in this throwaway society. So, I mean, the answer is easy. Unfortunately, we can't reach everybody or to force everybody to act the way in which we think they should. So.
Sorry, raising that awareness.
That's all.
Okay, thank you. And one more there, and then I'm going to get in trouble if I go on. So,
thank you very much. My name is Sarah Sprunk, and I work for the Dutch Embassy. And after living in the Netherlands, I also lived in Indonesia for some time, where both water issues and also air pollution are a big issue. And especially air pollution is a topic that we haven't discussed a lot, whereas I think it has a big impact on at least the melting of snow and the poles. And I was actually thinking, we're here with so many people, all stepping in airplanes as well, contributing to climate for all these interesting conferences. So I would like to end with a challenge. Let's think of a sustainable solution for getting together, because I do see the value and I enjoy it as well, but getting here without polluting with airplanes. And I dare and challenge everyone to contribute to that. Thank you so much.
Is there still a role for a moderator in that scenario?
Yes, it would be a pleasure.
All right. Look, thank you very much indeed. Thank you for all your comments. I think it's clear we could go on. The hands are beginning to pop up everywhere. But we are pushed for time, as we will be throughout the course of this conference. So thank you all for your contributions, for the word cloud and your remarks, but particularly a big thank you to our panel, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. And have a good rest of the afternoon and evening, and enjoy the rest of the conference. Thank you very much. Thank you.